When one speaks of the word simulation, they're either referring to the field of simulation, or perhaps they mean model execution. In the broader sense, when you say simulation, you're talking about the discipline or the area, computer simulation. But to simulate, or the act of simulation, is a form of executing the model, as differentiated from, say, designing or structuring or specifying a model, which are different activities. So simulation as a field then is often broken down into the design of the model and how to execute it on a digital computer. Now, there are three types of simulation that are important. The first is sequential, and that's what we're going to be talking about here. And with sequential simulation, it means that you've got a computer, a PC or Macintosh, for instance, and you're running your simulation on that machine. Or you may be running it on a server machine, which is still a single computer. The other two methods are parallel and distributed simulation, with parallel simulation involving a parallel computer that has many nodes for computation, and distributed meaning usually some sort of local area or wide area network of computers. So our focus in this talk will be on sequential model execution. Time is a critical element if you're talking about executing a model, simulating. When physicists talk about space-time, they're referring to three axes for space and one of time. So time in this sense is often referred to as being the fourth dimension, with the first three being for space. Say if it were a rectangular coordinate system, you'd be talking about X, Y, and Z for the spatial coordinates, and then time is your fourth dimension. Now, for most space-time scales, time can be thought about as being independent of space. However, at atomic or cosmological scales, they're tightly coupled. With relativity theory, you may have heard the terms time dilation or space or contraction of space. But for most of the kinds of simulations that we would get involved with, unless you're talking about simulation of physical phenomena at those particular scales, you can think about time as being independent. There are two types of time that are important to us. One is real time. Let's talk about that. Sometimes when people say real time, they mean physical time. This is the time on your watch, or the time on the wall clock. Now, this time may need to be synchronized, because chances are your watch may have stopped, or may be off by a minute or two. So one way of synchronizing it is with a clock that is extremely accurate, such as the cesium clock. And you can actually synchronize computer clocks that way. So the clock on your computer can be synchronized every so often or periodically with an atomic clock. And that way you get a nice synchronized time. But so synchronization becomes a critical part of dealing with time. Sometimes if you're in the mall, for instance, and you need to meet your spouse or your friend in an hour, you may say, well, let's synchronize watches. So it becomes an important issue. Real time or physical time is important because when you deal with a human, you need real time. Now, let me explain what I mean by that. When the human is in the loop, when the human is in the loop that contains the computer and the simulation, then the human is used to certain events in real life taking a certain amount of time. You know how long it takes for a horse to run, or for you to go out and get the paper, or for a certain for someone to drink their coffee. When you see these events, you expect it to say, take a certain amount of time. And therefore, any simulation which has you tightly in the loop, for instance, you're sitting in front of the computer screen, or you're engaged within the simulation because you've got special headgear on and so forth, then it's important that we deal with real physical time. Virtual time, or what's often called logical time, can be scaled up or down to match the process being simulated. So it can be sped up. Virtual time can be sped up as for geological processes. Geological processes take a long time, so the states associated with them, for instance, the positions of the geologic plates, take an incredible amount of time in terms of physical time. And so if we're going to do a simulation of, say, plate tectonics, we would certainly want to speed up that on the computer. There's no reason why we need wait on a geological time scale. We certainly don't have the time for that. Now, for molecular dynamics or something at that level, it's just the opposite. We need to slow time down for that because it happens much too fast with respect to human time or physical time. So virtual time is independent of physical time, and yet it can be mapped directly onto physical time by either speeding it up or slowing it down. Now we've considered time, let's look at key methods for doing model execution. The first is called, we'll call time slicing, or this can also be called fixed increment time advance, for instance. Now what time slicing involves is a kind of regular time advance. It means that time will advance as a variable in equal delta times. So if we consider delta t or delta time, delta time can change, but it changes on a regular in a regular fashion. This is frequently used for continuous time systems where the system is built from differential equations. So the differential equations might represent the model specification for a system. And then time slicing would be used as a way of incrementing time. But time might be made smaller in areas of the system where you needed more accuracy, and the delta time might be larger in areas where you didn't require as much accuracy, or where the system was not dynamically changing very much during that period of time. So this is often used for differential equations in continuous time, but it can also be used for difference equations where there is also a fixed delta, for instance, in terms of seconds, weeks, months, years. A lot of biological systems that one might simulate use that. Let's talk about the steps in time slicing. How do we actually achieve that? Well, really there's a couple of main steps. The first step is that you want to initialize your state variables. Your system will be composed of states and events, but in most cases the state variables are the most crucial part of the system that you're going to be studying, and you need to initialize them to be equal to some value. What you do then is you loop through all the functions and procedure, essentially procedures, everything that might be executable, and you execute these functions or procedures. For example, if you've got a continuous time system, you may be executing an integration function. If you've got a data flow diagram, then you may be executing the functional nodes that are part of that network or that diagram. And you end this loop whenever you want. And generally this is at a particular end time when you feel like ending it, or when the state variable equals a particular value or crosses a threshold. At this point of time, you decide that you want to end the simulation. So let's look at time slicing. With time slicing, we've got an axis, and we'll just label that time. And we've got a whole slew of state variables, which can be one per axis. So this might be the state variable called s, and this system may have multiple states. But for our purposes, really what we're looking at is the time advance. And for time slicing, you're looking at regular points in time, okay, where this delta t is exactly the same for each of these individual slices right down here. But as we mentioned before, you can have regular time slices, which doesn't mean equal necessarily. So we may be moving along merrily here and then decide to have the time slice delta t so that we have a 0.5 delta t or 1/2 delta t. And so suddenly our delta t is a half of what it was, and our times increment like this. So we move forward in time. We come back here, we move forward in time starting over here in delta t intervals. But then right here we have the time because perhaps we want more accuracy in our state variable that we're measuring up here called s. And so this is how the method of time slicing operates. The other major type, aside from time slicing, of model execution that we'll talk about is event scheduling. So when you hear the word discrete event dynamic system, discrete event simulation, discrete event model, you're talking about models that have events in them, and you're talking about an event scheduling mechanism which needs to be instrumented in order to simulate this kind of system. Event scheduling involves an irregular time advance as opposed to the regular time advance for time slicing or fixed increment a time advance. Basically, you hop through time at irregularly spaced time intervals. So think of a system that is driven by random events. This is likely the cause of a system that does this. If something is going to be irregular, there has to be an irregular cause that would give rise to these irregular time intervals. And often this is a source of randomness is the reason for that. For instance, in a queuing system, for instance, if you're waiting in line at a fast food restaurant, then you could consider the inter-arrival times or the service time, the amount of time it takes you to be serviced once you are in front of the line. These can be simulated as random events that take a certain amount of random amount of time. So they're definitely irregular. We don't exactly know when and at what boundary of time these events will occur. And so event scheduling is perfect for something like this. There are a couple of different types of event scheduling, but structured event scheduling is the one that uses an event list or data structure. You can do event scheduling without using data structures and just using simple variables, but it's more complex, and for any system but the most simplest, you would run into trouble. And so when people talk about event scheduling, are you talking about event scheduling using specific data structures? There are two key functions, next event and schedule, as part of these. And we'll go over those when we draw a little bit on the whiteboard. Okay, there's some key data structures that can be used. And the first thing that we need to note is what is actually going to be inserted or removed, for instance, from a data structure. And we'll call this an element. Generally, this is just the time that the event is to occur and some identification for the event, a number or a name. It can also include data, But minimally, you're usually just involving the pair time and event. The array is probably the simplest form of data structure. And it may be worthwhile, since we're talking now about a particular kind of data structure, what kind of operations we might have. And there are two major types of operations on these data structures. We'll call them the add and delete. When you add something to a data structure, you are doing an insertion for event scheduling. When you delete something, you are usually doing a get minimum operation, which means it's getting the event with the minimum time, the next time that for an event that's to occur. Or possibly you may want to cancel an event or delete an event from the future event list. So overall, you're usually talking about insertion, which is a kind of add, or get minimum, or cancel, which is a form of which involves basically deletion. So getting back to array is probably one of the simplest types of data structures that we could use for model execution, but linked list is the one that's often shown in books because it has a nice visual representation. And this is the way people, I think, would visualize a future event list if they had to. Although the linked list is not necessarily the most efficient because the insertion operation can be slow if the list is long. There's also heap, which is a type of priority queue, which is very efficient for most simulation programs. And so you probably find the heap to be one of the most commonly implemented discrete event data structures. Add and remove operations are relatively efficient for a heap. There's also some more exotic types of structures. There's something called a calendar queue, or what could be called a dynamic hash table. And hashing is where you get ultra-fast insertion. So if you're inserting an event, it's extremely fast. However, the remove part, the get minimum, is the thing that takes time because it involves a sequential search. There are many other types of data structures that can be used. In fact, there's probably hundreds of potential structures. And the ones that are most appropriate really depend on your application. It depends on the nature of how many events occur, when they occur, and the relative operations of addition and deletion when they occur. Depending on those things, a particular data structure can be prescribed. When we talk about event scheduling, what takes center stage is the future event list. So we're going to put future event list right up here. And future event list, we're going to look at it as a linked list, only because visually that's an excellent way of representing it, although internally it may be a heap, calendar queue, or some other kind of data structure. So what we're going to have is we're going to have the head of the list, of the linked list, and at the head of the list is where we're going to have the minimal time. So we may have, for instance, a time of an event, and the time might be 11.5. And the event number or ID might be 2. Okay. So this is the time, 11.5, and 2 is just a numerical ID for the particular event routine or event type that we are going to execute when we finally get to it. Okay, now what we can do then is we can go down this future event list to events which are going to occur after 11.5, and we can just start making up numbers. For instance, this event might occur at time 12.1 and it will be labeled event 1. This might be an event at 18.6 and it is also event 1, and we're just going to add one more event for good measure. This will be at time 35, and this will be event 4. Notice that the time is incremental in that it is it's advancing. It's monotonically increasing, 11.5, 12.1, 18.6, 35. In a future event list, you don't want to have a time, for instance, that is less than 12.1 sitting right here. That's just something that you want to avoid. The event list must be ordered. Okay, this will be the end of the list, and we'll just denote that like this, kind of a termination point. So basically, the event scheduling mechanism operates as follows. The first thing that happens is a next event occurs. Now, next event, which we're going to put right here, takes the next event off the future event list. So it's going to take this event right here, the event number 2 at time 11.5. And when it does that, it changes the virtual clock time. So the virtual clock time now will read 11.5. Next event also causes the event number 2 to occur. We're going to make the routine or the code associated with this 2, which you can think of as kind of a case or a switch number. Because often when it's coded, it is coded just like that, as in a case statement or switch statement. You'll execute 2. So over here, this will point to 2, which then is going to have lines of code that need to be executed. And there, of course, may be other events, 1, 3, and 4, with 1, 2, and 4 being represented, at least in this list that we've got up here. And so there are going to be lines of code that need to be executed for each one of these. Okay, now an important part of this process is that likely one of the statements inside of this 2 or 1 or 3 or 4 is going to have a schedule in it. Which means that an event is to be scheduled. Let's say that an event number 3 is to be scheduled at time 15.7. What that means is that a new element will be inserted into the list right here. Okay, so this is what we call really the event scheduling list, the event scheduling loop, rather. So you've got a future event list right up here. And let's go ahead and use another color so that we can represent what's going on here. You've got your future event list. The next event takes the element off of the front of the list, sets the current time to whatever time was happened to be in that element, causes the event routine associated with the number in that element to occur, which causes this code then to go ahead and execute. And within these code segments, you are likely to have a schedule which schedules new events, which causes the future event list, or FEL, to be increased in size. So next event is decreasing the size of the future event list, making it smaller, and all these schedules are increasing it. And so it's just a matter of the future event list being of a certain size that reflects relatively how many schedules you have versus how many next events.